In this video, I'm going to talk about the writing style and the language of the introduction section. Now, just so you remember, the introduction is the first section of your scientific paper. Okay, the first point I want to talk about is how to make your writing easy to read. Okay, first let's talk about paragraphs. Paragraphs divide your writing into sections that the readers can easily see. This helps to make your paper easier to read. Let's look at this example, which is a lab report on how beavers find food based on the trees around them. Now you can easily see the paragraphs. Here's one, here's another, here's the third one, and here's the last one. Now basically these are the rules for writing clear paragraphs. You should have one topic per paragraph. Paragraphs should start with a topic sentence. You should have no irrelevant sentences. And they should not be too long or too short. So basically, you don't want to have a whole bunch of really short paragraphs, and you don't want to have paragraphs that are one page long. Basically, 2 to 3 paragraphs per page is good. Let's just take a quick look at this paper again. Now, for example, this second paragraph here, this starts with, "The central place theory is used to describe animals that collect food and store it at a fixed location in their home range, the central place." And there's a citation. Okay, and then they explain more details about the central place theory. So this paragraph is all about the central place theory. That's the one topic. This paragraph explains the optimal foraging theory, and all this is about that, okay? This paragraph is explaining the main purpose of the study. You can see here they start with the main objective of this lab, and even they finish up with the purpose of this lab was to learn about. Okay, so you can see that each paragraph has one topic. It starts with a sentence that introduces what that topic is. And you can see that we have about two, three, or four paragraphs per page. Okay, it looks like about 2.5 over here, and here's the reference section. Okay, so that it helps you when you look at the paper to easily see what the sections are. Okay, the other thing that you should do in your paper is to use transition words. Transition words like these words help to make connections between your sentences and between your paragraphs so that it will be easier for people to read it and follow your argument. You can use this flowchart to check if your paragraphs are following all the rules. Okay, the next topic we're going to talk about is the verb tenses. Basically, you might remember that the method section is almost entirely in past simple. It's very easy to write. The introduction's not so easy. You don't have to use all 8 of these. Basically, these are the 3 tenses that you're going to be using in academic writing in general. But especially in the introduction, you'll be using all 3 of these. Now, basically, the past tense is used for specific results or findings, or talking about other people's methods or your method. The present perfect, this one, is used for non-specific findings. So when you're talking about combinations of lots of research, okay, it's also used a lot in passive sentences. And then this one, the present simple, is used for facts and the results of other people's research, if you state it as a fact. Now let's look at some examples in real research papers. This is a paper that examines the reasons that competitors in combat sports who wear red uniforms win more. The first paragraph explains the background to this study, what other people have found about the effect of red on winning in sports and what other people think about it. Now you'll notice Hill and Barton showed. Okay, this was talking about their research paper, so this is in past tense. But this point here, wearing red sports attire has a positive impact on a combat sport, because that's true. That's the true result of their study. Okay? And again, they suggested past tense. Here's another one. These guys, Rowe, Harris, and Roberts, criticized this argument. That's another paper. Okay, again, past tense. In the next paragraph, we're explaining the hypothesis of the study. In this case, they use the present tense to talk about the hypothesis. We disagree with both interpretations. we propose that the perception of color triggers a psychological effect. Now, this point here, this comes from previous research, but they don't say the names of the authors. They're just talking about this as a fact. Referees and umpires exert a major influence on the outcome of sports competitions. It's a fact, and it comes from this source. Athletes frequently make very rapid movements, and referees have to view sports competitions, okay? And that comes from this source. As a result, their judgments may show biases. Okay, therefore, we believe that is the referees. Now, the last part here, when you talk about the statement of purpose, so why you did this study, what you did. Because of the effect, we conducted a new experiment and found. So this is past tense when you're talking about your own research or your own experiment. So if you talk about your own experiment or other people's experiments, it's going to be in past tense. If you talk about the results, which are facts, then those are going to be in present tense. Okay, here's another paper. This is the one on anti-browning agents on apple slices. And here's the introduction. Okay, we start here reviewing what we know about this topic. With the consumer's increased awareness of health benefits, there is an increasing demand for higher quality. Okay, that's true. This is kind of reviewing not a particular company, but the food industry in general has focused on the development of new processing techniques. So they're not talking about one specific company or one specific point in history. They're just talking about over many years, the food industry has focused. This one is also a fact. Processing operations such as peeling, cutting, and shredding induce enzymatic browning. Okay. Of these, enzymatic browning, here we go, has been the major concern with regard to aesthetic quality. And this is because, again, it's not a specific point in history. It's over a long time. Here's another present perfect one. A replacement has been urgently sought. And then you can see there's at least two studies that are discussing this, not one particular one. So when you're reporting things that involve lots of different research, then it needs to be in present perfect. Now here's an example of, again, one particular research paper reported. Most of the reported, again, this is reviewing previous research, were measured. And now here we get to our statement of purpose, the point of this study. The overall relative inhibitory activity of individual compounds is not clear. And again, the main purpose of this study was to find. So when you're talking about your statement of purpose or what you did for the experiment, that should be past tense. Okay, just to sum up, when you're choosing your grammatical tense, it kind of depends a little bit on how you say what you want to say. So here I have examples of the same point. They're slightly different, but basically they have the same information. The first one uses present perfect. Wearing red clothing has been shown to influence the outcome of sports competitions. Okay. The next one uses the names. Hill and Barton, 2005, found that wearing red clothing influences the outcome of sports. And then the last one, present tense. Competitors who wear red clothing are more likely to win in sports competitions. Finally, just to review, when you're writing the introduction, make sure you organize in paragraphs with one topic, topic sentence, no irrelevant sentences, and be careful of your tenses. Past simple for specific results and methods, present simple for facts, present perfect for general findings or mini studies.